First of all, Carlo, you live in Rome, but you spent a considerable amount of time here in New York. And when was that?
So, yes, I lived here, let's say, from 2002 to 2007, more or less.
Sorry.
It's a Siri, it's acting up.
Siri, hi. What do you want to ask,
anything
Siri?
Anything working with Siri.
That's not bad. So a little thing I can say about my staying here is that when I first moved, I moved for other reasons. I was doing documentaries for the Italian television at the beginning. And then I started to research, because I wanted to make a documentary on the intersex community in America. And at the time, the first associations were forming here. So I met a lot of people that that I started to follow with my camera. I would interview them, etc., and I really discovered a lot about these people's lives, etc. And once I started to collect the material, I realized that it would have been nice to make a film out of it. And so I never edited the documentary. I still have the footage at home. But I then went back to Italy, where I wanted to make the film. And I sort of put together stuff from the material I had collected from the documentary. I also had, after I met someone in Italy called Arianna, who's the girl I named the film after, that eventually, unfortunately, she died. That was the first girl I met in Italy in this condition. And we discussed a lot, we would talk, and she really, shared her life, her,
And Carlo, so the idea of the documentary about intersexual persons was your own. It had nothing to do with your job for Rai Television.
Nothing.
For them, you were basically interviewing American film directors, is that
yes.
correct?
Yes. Yeah, yeah, I was doing documentaries on cinema.
Okay, that was your own project. And so you have all these footage of interviews, mostly, with intersexual people. But then when you arrived in Italy and met Arianna, you decided to make a feature film centering around her figure. So is this basically Arianna's story with corrections and changes? So the real Arianna?
Yeah. Not really, because this is more, so this film, the reality is that comes from that, so there's, on one side, there's the research I did in America, but the reason I did the research is because it actually came from a set of dreams that I had when I was little. Because when I was like 8 or 9, I would dream of being a woman, like an older woman, so like a 30, 35-year-old. And I would wake up puzzled because I didn't know, why I would, there were quite recurrent dreams. So I didn't have any answers at the time. I just like was, not shocked, but yeah, a little bit, And I think that seed stayed in me. I guess it was something, when you ask yourself growing up, probably, who am I, why am, am I here? So some ontological question about yourself.
You can tell he has a degree in philosophy from the University of Rome, at Sapienza. Go on with the ontological questions. I'm following you.
Relating to the being, I don't know.
Of course. That's perfect. God, yeah. That is perfect. By the way, I want to thank my colleague Nicoletta Marini-Maio at Dickinson College, because Carlo is right now an artist in residence at Dickinson College. And it's thanks to them that he's in the United States, and we took advantage of his presence here to invite him to New York.
Yes, sure.
Let's go back to the ontological, yeah. Carlo.
No, so basically it was a personal reason. That's why with the film, is accurate, but if there's some things that are not completely accurate, is because I want to, at that point, I kind of related my feelings that were, my about identity in general, and I sort of found, intersexuality, hermaphroditism, to be a good way to tell that kind of, issues, or to portray, to describe, to, so it's permanently personal, I would say. And also, in fact, it's a thematic film for me, so not everything, I just wanted to show certain things that occur to these people, not everything, only certain things that are quite recurrent and that I would relate to. So sometimes there's like gaps or there are jumps and stuff, but because it's a thematic film. It's really like an inner thing. In fact, to me, it opens and ends with the same thing. It's a sort of like, it stays in his own world. You don't know if it's all real or, you know, or not. I leave that to you, but you know, that was my idea, sort of.
Okay, I think we can open the floor, sir.
Beautiful film, for sure. But does it take very long into it to realize that this is not specifically a film about this coming of age. It's more a film about her physical condition or problems, which she's trying to find out what exactly they are. We more and more know every day that transgender issues and so on are very widespread, but how widespread is the condition of actual hermaphroditism? One tends to think of that in, mostly in terms of mythological characters, you know. Is this a very widespread
condition, you mean?
Yeah.
Well, as far as my, you know, as I'm concerned, I think when I started to make the film, I think that it's not as common, but it's pretty common. So I would say probably 3.5 million people in the world. So it's like a fairly big city, I would say. So compared to the 7 billion people we are, it's not a huge percentage. But still, it's quite enough to you know, it's a condition. It's a condition of living. It's like, you know, but yeah, I don't know. To me, it was a way, like you're saying, there's some mythological aspect to it that I was, you know, fascinated by. There were, you know, so it was like a condition that I could relate to in speaking about identity, discovery, like you're saying, of oneself. I could have picked up a transgender, I could have picked up, for some reason I felt that like being born in this condition, because you're by nature, and your nature, I guess, I hope, in the film, the struggle of the nature to come out, you know, it's really what it's concerning Arianna. So she's fighting, her nature is fighting against what is, you know, has been imposed to her, or, you know, the culture, or whatever you want to call that. So, you know, it was a personal.
And I would say that it is a coming of age film of a girl in a very particular condition. But I agree with you that choosing these specific condition, intersexuality, it's also a helpful device, if you allow me, to bring up issues of identity, and not only of gender identity, but of all the other issues that come up at this age where you're uncertain about everything and you're really at the discovery of yourself. Of course, she's up for some major discovery that has been kept secret to her, but there is something in common of these specific age bracket that is constant investigation and questioning about who you are and what you're doing and who you're there for and so on.
Yeah. Sir.
Yeah. So I mean, I interviewed. I interviewed parents, and I mean, and I interviewed people in this condition, asking, you know, how, you know, however their parents reacted in, you know, in their cases. I picked a specific type of parent. I mean, there are parents that are very open. There are parents that are don't even, you know, decide for the surgery. They just like leave them the way they are, and that's how, you know. And I think it's pretty much how medicine is trying to, you know, behave nowadays, to let, you know, although there's still happening this, you know, in Rome, for instance, there's a whole hospital that are still, you know, making these surgeries. I'm sure in America it's happening as well. So I picked a specific kind of parent.
Are there general guidelines of the American Psychiatric Association or any other medical association going more in one direction than another, like don't do the surgery, or the surgery should still be considered, or it's still wide open, the scientific and psychological debate on the issue. And then we go back to the parents, I'm sorry.
No, yeah, trying to maybe incorporate. I mean, I'm not aware if there's any, you know, memorandum or anything that you have to follow specifically. Mm-hmm. I think that it's pretty open. I mean, in Italy, it's really left to the, you know, to the doctor's suggestion, as it's happening, you know, like you were seeing in the film. There are like psychologists, you know, psychoanalysis that are helping maybe the decision. And in my case, because of the father was a doctor and he was so sure of the decision he took, then, I mean, he didn't question himself as much, you know. He was really like thinking of, you know, taking the right decision. And that's how he, I was trying to describe that kind of parents, people that are, you know, think they did the right decision. They just like, you know, follow that in, to the extent that the father is even able to share something very masculine, like go like I had the hunting scene or do like masculine things, because he's so sure of like the decision he took that even liking the male part of the girl is a, you know, you can still not be, you know, afraid of that, you know.
And you interviewed parents both in the States and in Italy?
Yes, both, both. I remember, I mean, especially following one of these girls, ladies that I followed at the time, going to Bellevue, going to hospitals here in New York. She was an advocate at the time, and, you know, we would talk to parents, you know, sharing, you know, really at the beginning, you know, they were still deciding what to do with, you know, with their child. And mostly they were, you know, this girl I was following was suggesting them not to do anything. But there are cases that might, you know, you might have a tumor developing, so you have to, you know, get the surgery, you have to operate. But maybe you have to operate not completely. So I'll make you a quick example. I have a friend of mine, really like a good friend of mine in Italy. She's now 29, something like that. When she was 10, so older than Arianna, she... They told her that they had to operate her, okay? And didn't tell her much about what it was, but what she found out later is that basically they changed, they kind of, she had a problem because the genitalia weren't fully developed. So her vagina wasn't, you know, fully developed. But she was 10. And instead of like saying, okay, let's wait until you're, you know, in an age, you know, you reach an age where you can have, you know, sexual intercourses and, you know, eventually, you know, decide. They, you know, took a piece of her intestine and replaced with the intestine and made a vagina of the intestine, which is another tissue, another thing. It has another, you know, it's a completely different thing. So, and she had many problems, and that was a moral decision. There was nothing else involved. There was no reason why.
No medical reasons. No
medical, not evident reason to fix that at that time. And she was, you know, of course she was suffering for that.
Yes?
Yes. There are two questions. I'm repeating because it was not loud enough, especially for the recording. The lady was asking, first of all, about the walk of the actress that plays Arianna. It's a rather masculine walk, and she was wondering whether Carlo directed her that way, whether that was something that came naturally to her. And the other thing is that aside from the surgical operations, there is something in the brain. Are there studies about the effects that these surgeries might have on the brain? The brain was not changed with the surgery.
Once again, I think so. As far as the body language, we worked on the body language. We tried to to get to a point where she would be masculine, but not too masculine and, you know, feminine. What happened, and that's something interesting, what happened throughout the film, but while we were filming, is that she kind of changed herself. She kind of took Arianna's, you know, a wish of willingness of being a woman, even if it was something, you know, that she didn't have in herself, but, you know, this idea of I want to become a woman because I have to be a woman because it's right to be a woman and I have to act as a woman, I have to have a boyfriend and so on and so on. Even Ondina is the name of the actress, and she's homosexual. Actually, no, she's bisexual, but like, you know, she's certainly concerned, you know, she was wondering about herself at the time where she was shooting. She would become day after day more and more feminine. So she was losing up even a little bit the walk, so we had to work again on the body. And so she was becoming really like more feminine. It was something strange. The brain, I'm not sure if there are any studies on the behavior. I think that probably goes to each one's identity. So I think all of us are, you know, have our own perspective. I can be feminine, masculine, or whatever. I don't know, it depends.
And by the way,
so many nuances that it's hard to say for me.
She's an amazing actress. She did an exceptional performance.
She's not an actress, by the way. So, you know, obviously, she had to find her. She's now, yes, I guess.
She's really amazing. Really, no, I mean, great, great like performance.
A nice job.
Yes, and then...
Nowadays, it's not so unusual to see women frequently, even famous stars, frequently doing topless scenes in a film. But these scenes were so completely natural, that even in the full nudity, that seems to me that's, I'm not sure I've seen that in American films, but in Italian, you're so frank about the sexuality here that in your showing the sex scenes, there's not, and this is because you're so frank about this, there's not a hint of any oral foreplay. Now, is that something that simply beyond anything that interested you in getting into, or is that something Italians are just not
interested in? I want to see how you handled that, Carlo. Go ahead.
I love it. No, no, we are interested in that accent as well. Exactly. Don't worry. We're pretty much the same. No, I guess. Well, yeah. No, the nudity.
That could be the tagline for the film. We are all pretty much the same.
We're all the
same. It's a great tagline for Arianna.
Yeah, that would be a nice one. Yeah. No, the nudity, I think, I mean, when you make this kind of film, you know, you have to be frank, even with the actress right away, you know, and tell her this is something that talks about the body, the discovery of the body, the displaying of the body. You have a problem with yourself, with your body, etc. So you don't have to be ashamed of showing it because there's nothing to be ashamed of. It's not that we're shooting a porn or anything, you know.
It's a medical thing. It's not a medical thing. It's not a sexuality per se.
Yeah, exactly. There's no, you're right. Yeah, there's no, to that extent, and not that kind of voyeurism, maybe a different one, but not that one, you know? So to me, it was, and it's interesting because Ondina, she wasn't ashamed of showing her body. She understood quite immediately. She would even like, you know, she would, I remember, walk, you know, on the set naked without paying attention to that. But what was hard for her was to actually take out her emotions. So it was way harder to let her cry than to have her naked, for instance. So like how mm-hmm. different we are to that extent, you know? Anyway, so I think that's my...
Yes. Sir, we move on to other people.
No, but because it's more, you know, a genital point in this film, I guess.
Yes, ma'am.
It's the same surgery either way.
So, why don't they say we should wait until?
From what I heard, that the reasons are really the ones that she tells in the end. It's like they are ashamed that maybe you're not accepted in your, you know, among your friends or among the community. They're afraid that you can't take a shower when you're going to the gym or maybe, you know, sharing with the swimming pool. Those are stupid things if you think about
it. Issues of social acceptance, mostly.
But social acceptance is a big thing, you know, and really, you know, it sounds weird, but they were all talking about the social acceptance side aspects, you know.
Yes.
Yeah, well, I just
want
to say it's a beautiful and sensitive film, and I thank you.
No, thank you.
But I'm wondering if you have a point of view on that. I mean, what does a parent do? You know, I understand that social acceptance, but also kids who are bullied, just normal bullying, often never get over it. So you can imagine a parent wants to protect their child. And yet, as you show, it's really so hard to know what to do.
You never win.
Yeah. From all this research that you've done, like, if you were in this situation, what do you think you would do?
Hey, it's really hard. I would probably wait. You know, I would probably for how long? I would say probably as long as, you know, he is aware of the problem, and I would probably try to talk. Because I found parents with a kid in the same condition. They were so open and they were so accepting with this little boy, you know, it was strange because then even like the environment would react to that acceptance. Then of course you don't never know when you were in the elementary school or later on. Yes, they would probably be, you know, bullied or anything, but I would wait. And there are parents that wait. If you know, but sometimes I'm just saying there are like there's a type of surgery you have to do. It's like if you have testicles that are not descended, they're internal. No, they're like where the ovaries are. And you don't know that, and you don't even. And sometimes you don't even realize what is happening until puberty comes in, and then you start to develop. We go into very specific themes here. I'm not want to be medical about it, but just because I did the research, I know a little bit. But that's explained. Even I don't know if you read Middlesex, the novel. That it's very well, you know, explained there. It's different. She didn't go through surgery. She was like, you know, completely left away. But they didn't know exactly because she eventually, when she was 12, 13, 14, she would start to change because like new hormones would come, and you know, basically you start to change. And that's another thing. It's hard, but either way, like you were saying, it's
also
hard.
I had an adult student who, at our school, we read Becoming Nicole as the freshman book, and that author came, it's about a transsexual. But an adult student of mine, after this thing, burst out crying and told us that her daughter is sex neutral. And that's where the brain doesn't know. I mean, she's a girl, physically, but she insists being referred to as they because she has not made up her mind. She's in betwixt and between. So that's another, you know,
situation.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yes, ma'am?
Yeah, it's society in Italy more open vis-a-vis New York or the United States? Which country is more open?
It really depends on where and how, I think. So I've noticed, big cities are more open just because you're more anonymous, maybe sometimes, or maybe a smaller. Although, like, I've been to small villages that they, you know, the case of the girl I was talking to you about, the boy that I was talking to you about that was more accepted, they lived in a small community. They kind of all knew about it. They were all okay with it because they all accepted it. So there was, eventually the problems will come later on. So in Italy, sometimes you go to a very, like, to maybe a place that you would think it's super conservative, and then they are completely fine with it, that you wouldn't expect that because, you know. So it surprises you. The more bourgeois are maybe the most conservative, and they play that they're like progressive, and then they're like, oh my God, I have to make the surgery right away.
Like the parents here, you know, that
like
are
like the parents
similar,
here, and I found very, men in Italy.
Like almost like neo-hippies of some sort. And
The Catholic Church, I mean, it's but the Catholic Church also I mean, of course they have problems, you know, in but I think like local priests or local people, they kind of again tend to accept because they understand the specific thing. Then one thing is the Pope and, you know, the official Catholic, you know,
hierarchy,
and that's, you know, of course there's conservatism.
Yes, sir.
I think I've seen one film years ago that I knew the film before I was doing this. So it was kind of not an inspiration, but I was aware of the film, and it treats differently, of course. So I also was, you know, careful not to repeat the movie. And it's a beautiful film from Argentina, and it's called XXY. Really nice film, really beautiful. A different story, taken from a different, you know, angle, but it's very nice. And after this, I'm sure there are other films. I know there's one film, but I haven't seen it, in France called Tiresias, something like that. And it's about a hermaphrodite guy, let's say.
And there is one episode in Fellini's Satyricon.
Oh, absolutely. And the Satyricon, of course, I love.
And we know that it's a pure Fellini thing, but it's nowhere to be found in Petronio's Satyricon. So we know that that is something that he added to the story. And it's a very sad and moving story. And and it's beautifully done. Yes.
Beautifully done. The scene is incredible.
One of the
episodes.
Snippets of the fragments that make Fellini's Satyricon. Yes, ma'am, and then you, sir.
Where was this film, and do you have a distribution for it?
Where, in America, you mean, or in general? If you have a distribution,
Where was it filmed in Italy? From which part of Italy?
Okay, sure. And then do you have So we filmed in a region that it's between northern Lazio, which is the region of Rome, and southern Tuscany. It's a region where my grandma is from. Also, I'm sort of from. It's a very beautiful region because it's a little unknown. It's wild. There's a lot of Etruscan ruins, so even pre-Roman stuff. That to me, it's really magical. There's something magical in that region. There's this lake, it's a volcanic lake with this, you know, I don't know. So when I decided to shoot the film in Italy, one of the reasons that I wanted to shoot the film in this region, because I knew it very well, because it had, you know, this kind of side. So basically,
the lake is the Lake of Bolsena.
Bolsena,
right?
Lake. Yeah, it's like probably, see, Lago di Bolsena. It's like 100 miles north of Rome. Not that far. So the film actually has now a couple of years. So we presented at the Venice Film Festival. Then we traveled around. We were even at the Lincoln Center, as you said.
Yeah.
And I think it's not me dealing with the distribution. I think we sold it to a distribution, but I don't know what after that. I'm not sure what's happening. I would say pretty good. I mean, people liked it and hated it. So it's like, you know, I mean, like every film, I guess. I mean, you like it or don't like it, or you like some, maybe something's not. I mean, it's a first film also. So, I mean, there are like obviously things that don't work. But overall, I would say that it went well. I mean, the critic was fairly, you know, positive, I would say. And the people also liked it. It's a bit complicated when you get to distribution once again, because, I mean, you have to... But it came out, we went to everywhere in Italy, and also in Europe with shows, so it was nice. It was a good adventure, you know.
And I just want to mention something else that Carlo did. It's a totally American film called The Hip Hop Diaries, that is actually a documentary about several New York characters that have in common that they are trying to get out of the ghetto, basically, in which they were born and they grew up. And it's one rapper, right? And who are the other characters?
That's a documentary that I did like 10 years ago. So it was something that I did while I was here, but that I really loved doing it. It's a very different project.
Yes.
It was something like very, like even smaller than this, apparently. But I follow different characters from different, you know, from the South Bronx and Washington Heights, etc. It was fun. It was like everyone struggling to make a living out of, you know, by doing anything.
It's,
you know.
And it's interesting that it's a film called The Hip Hop Diaries by an Italian director. And another project you worked on is an interview with Christo, the international renowned artist. And you did an interview with him, and you're about to come up with a full-fledged documentary about his project that he realized last year on another Italian lake, the Passerelle. There. Yeah. So when is that coming out?
No, so basically that is something that I'm not the director of that. We are co-producing.
Mm-hmm.
So we're helping them to do the documentary on this, you know, the guy who did the gates and so on here. And he did a beautiful project in Italy this summer called the Floating Piers. So basically you would walk on a lake, on the water, on this, you know, piers, really nice. And he's doing another one in 4 years in Doha, I think. So we kind of, you know, we joined them while they were doing it, and they loved the guy that was working with them. So they kind of, you know, decided to have us as co-producers. And now we're editing it, and eventually...
You'll bring it to us.
Yes, for sure. Yes, we will. Absolutely.
And with this, I would like to ask you to please help me thank Carlo Lavagna.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.